Well, let's see here. How we go here. Welcome to the next segment of the BTS vlog. It is 0 hours and 8 minutes into the day of Friday, February 20th. No, Saturday, February 20th, 2014. I completely missed Thursday and Friday. I had a down day between Wednesday and Friday. I had a down day, well, a couple down days, where I wasn't really, the amount of work I got done on my schedule really kind of fell off. I got stuck working on a project that took me longer than expected, and this is sort of the typical thing. The projects will trip me up, and I'll spend longer than I expect to on a particular project. And the thing is, I do try to schedule the project in and stop when I need to stop in terms of maintaining a schedule, but that's not always possible. More often than not, what happens when you're working on a project, you have to stop when you've got all the work done. In other words, you start working on something and you're working on a good chunk of work. It doesn't always end, well, more often than not, it never ends. More often than not, it doesn't end in a neat, time schedule. There are always extras that need to be taken a look at, in order to sort of end that project. And that's sort of what happened starting on Wednesday. I started looking at, looking into the history of Daesh, looking into the history of the Middle East, and sort of trying to piece things together. And the project that I was, that section of the project that I was working on, because I break things up into sub-projects as well, ended up taking long because I ended up finding more material than I expected to find. But this is sort of means that I'm going to have to go back in once again because I found new sources. Try to figure out how to present what I've found and when to present what I've found, because the timing of not only the way you present things, but the timing of the presentation will determine what type of impact that you're going to have on the regular public. So these are kind of the things that I have to go through and work out. And as I said, it doesn't, more often than not, it doesn't leave you the time you need to have to always have a half decent day where you're getting a large quantity of projects done or sub projects done. You're just getting one or two sub-projects done, and everything else kind of falls by the wayside. And that's kind of the way things go. This is what open research, this is what exploration research is about. It is about going into the unknown and finding the unexpected. You're not going to always have, well, you're almost never going to have something that's going to be standard or exceptional, you know, in terms of, not exceptional, but status quo. It's not going to be normal. You're going to have these, exceptions to the rule. You know, this sort of exceptional behavior, if you will. And I think that's where we're going to be going with this. And the same thing with the vlog. I don't know if I'll be able to schedule a daily vlog in here. So they're going to be, because the schedule is erratic, the vlog itself is going to exhibit these erratic behaviors. So hopefully over the weekend I can start editing and uploading these videos and get them out. Anyways, I will talk to you in the next segment of the BTS vlog. It's time for me to go have breakfast. Yeah, I'm just starting my day at midnight now. Before I was starting at 2, 3 o'clock in the morning, now I'm starting at midnight. For somehow the time, my time has shifted backwards. I'm not going to bed at 2, you know. Normally we expect, okay, 3 o'clock in the morning, then go 6 o'clock in the morning and have the day progress forward, but it's not, it's going backwards now. So, anyways, that's the way things are working out. So, hey, I'll see you in the next segment of the BTS vlog. All right, take it easy and goodbye. Morning, yeah. it is about 2:40 in the morning, 2 o'clock. Two o'clock. Well, a little past 2:30. My mind is a little off. I haven't completely woken up yet. I'll be doing that in a few minutes. So it is 0 hours and 41 minutes into the day of Sunday, February 21st, 2016. Projects are not always as easy as they seem. As I said, the unexpected always occurs. Your timeline and schedules are always being messed up. And I was looking more carefully at it yesterday when I was doing the work, and I realized that a lot of times the information that you want is in bits and pieces. It's not a lot of stuff, but but in order to get through that to that little bit, you have to do close to 6 hours worth of reading and observing. And so what happens, and the hard part is that, because it's not all together, and you're watching for tiny little bits and pieces, and this is done, you're looking for these tiny bits and pieces over 6 hours, your mind isn't always there for 6 hours. You know, it's hard to keep your focus for 6 hours. And so you miss bits and pieces, and so you have to go back over and do things again. And this is sort of the situation that sort of been popping up, this last little project. I'm trying to get this project off the ground and into videos. And it is observational work, but the thing is that the initial observational work that before I get to the editing and in the videos is taking up almost every day, taking up 6 hours, a 6 hour chunk of the day, and that is basically, if my day is 12 hours, that's half my day, and so that's the reality of what's actually going on here, is that I don't actually have the time to sort of get everything done on terms of my project or schedule, that I have on schedule for the day, because the project is taking up so much time. But that's kind of the way things go, and the struggle is to, you know, when you do have a better day, when you do have things more organized, that's when you begin to start trying to work ahead, and you try to sort of, on the days the workflow seems to be going well, that's when you try to sort of pick things up and get as much done those good days as you can, because you know on the bad days, you'll be stuck on one project for close to 7 hours, and after you get up, the day is more or less shot, because studying for 7 hours straight, because the focus is there just for 7 hours complete, it's gonna tax you. It's gonna drain all and sap all your energy, and so you do need to take about a 2 hour nap, particularly for your eyes. If you look at in even my past video, how dark my eyes are, the part of the problem is if you look at it carefully and close enough, you'll see that my eyes, around here, they're not just that they're black, they're bruised, and that's because the reading that you're doing is so intense. Your focus is so intense in terms of using your eyes that it actually bruises the muscles around the eyelid. So and that's what dark eyes are, the black eyes in the sort of, it's fatigue. No, it's not necessarily fatigue. If you look at the coloring there, if you look carefully, they're bruises, and that means the eyelids have been worked to the point that, because they are muscles, and reflect what's going on with the eyes, that you can see that they're bruised, that you've overused these eyes. So you do need to take a couple hours worth of rest after 7 hours of straight work. So if you take, let's say, 3 hours for rest, That's 10 hours into your day, because 7 hours is the research, 3 hours is the rest for your eyes. And now you've got 2 hours left for the day. And that's kind of how things go. So, that is, you know, this is sort of an explanation of why things are the way they are. And let's see if day by day we can improve. I mean, sort of, the thing is, we haven't got to uploading it because that massive project is sitting there taking up 10-hour chunks of the day. So we'll see what happens today. We'll see how much farther we can get today. And hopefully I will see you in the next segment of the Big Bang Theory RL. And when that is, I have no idea. Alrighty, take it easy. Well, hello everybody. Once again, it's time for the next segment of the Big Bang Theory RL. I got up around 3:40 this morning. So yeah, it's about 10 minutes past 4. Let me give you the time and date stamp. It's 4 hours and 9 minutes into the day of Monday, February, I think it's the 22nd, 2016. And it's time for, as I said, another segment of the Big Bang Theory RL. I was calling it a while ago BBTRL. That's Big Bang Theory RL. Just sort of give it an acronym. But since we're starting all over again, you know, with a new background, a new outlook, I thought maybe that give it a long-term name so people could get used to it, and then from there, maybe, I don't know, a couple months from now, we'll shorten it down to BBTRL. I don't know. We'll see what happens. I don't really know what happens from day to day here. I get up. I have my routine of just sort of getting up whenever I get up, and then working until basically can't work anymore, and I have to come back to bed, and you know, then you sleep and get up and start the process all over again. So that's kind of the way things are going here. So this is going to some ways be reflected in the vlog. The drama here is, if you will, the drama behind the show. Is, for those of you who like reality shows, is that there is a struggle here. That there's a struggle to always be pushing the boundary, struggles to find something new. To find something new. As I said before, you could do more often than not when you're doing to get maybe 5-10 minutes worth of notes, good notes. You're doing 6 hours worth of observation just to get the tiny little chunk. And it's not until enough chunks line up, so you could be doing a month of this, before you have any significant results in terms of what you're trying to understand, because you're using these new results, right, that they're basically not in the textbook, to go back and say, okay, well, what am I seeing compared to what the textbook says, you know. What is our standard knowledge? What are we seeing? Does what we see match up with our standard knowledge? And in many cases, as you do the observations, you begin to realize that the observations do not match up with the textbook or standard knowledge. And this is where you start realizing you're beyond the textbook, and that there is a beyond the textbook, so that there is a beyond the standard knowledge. And then you go, well, what is standard knowledge? Well, standard knowledge is what most people get. If you have your bachelor's degree, most people are within standard knowledge. There are few people who say the bachelor's degree is common. That's your upper limit of the standard knowledge to a certain degree, because you also have people who don't go to college at all, who don't get their bachelor's degree. And they're more or less, they're vocationally minded. You know, they work with their hands, so to speak. That doesn't mean that they don't know anything. It just means that their sense of knowledge is fundamentally different from those who have a bachelor's degree. So a person with a bachelor's degree will have a different sense of knowledge than a person who is vocationally trained, who works with their hands, and is not academically trained. But this is the whole problem here. academic training is just that. It's training. It doesn't teach you, it doesn't give you the freedom of thought. So even when those, you take the bachelor's degree as the most common degree that people get. You know, people, you finish high school, you go to university, you get your degree, and that's what they talk about. There are very few people talking about going to get their PhD. As a matter of fact, when I talk to most young people, they're always talking about going, getting the degree and getting the job. They talk about the vocation of their degree. In other words, they're going to get their degree to get a job, and nothing more. There's no more expansion of the mind than that. So you go specifically for what you want to get a job in, and that's the extent that your academic experience is in. But there are those who say, well, I want something more. And they're the ones who typically tend to go for their PhDs. And of those few, even when they do go for their PhDs, the system is geared such that in order to get a job with your PhD, you have to go back into the system. And in order to go back into the system, you have to bring in something known as status quo. You really can't go too far outside the system in terms of what you can research and what you can study and where your knowledge can go. So again, you are, even with a PhD, you're still within standard knowledge, but you're just slightly above where you would be if you were a bachelor, if you had just simply had a bachelor's. It's not until you begin to question standard knowledge, called the textbook knowledge, that you really begin to start to deviate from standard knowledge and move into the more expansive, the riskier advanced knowledge or non-textbook, non-standard knowledge. And I'm not going to call it more advanced because it's not necessarily more advanced. It just doesn't meet the standard. It's something that in many cases contradicts standard knowledge. And this is a case of sometimes you'll see it, you'll observe it, but it won't make sense in the standard knowledge sense. And this is this is what you see actually in quantum physics. Quantum physics is an excellent example, is where you start going off the edge of standard knowledge, and as you begin to research quantum physics, you begin to go off into an area where the observation does not meet standard knowledge. It is not logical. It's anti-logical. And this is where you start saying, okay, there's something more here, and you begin to do your research. But a lot of research tries to pull your observation and understanding back into the standard or accepted view of knowledge. And that's actually incorrect. You shouldn't be trying to pull things back into standard knowledge. You're supposed to allow, and this is the way I work, is you allow your research to dictate where things are going from one point to the next. So if you never end up back in your standard in standard knowledge, then that's all right, because that's just simply where the research has led you. You're going from observation to observation. And even with a sum of observation, if you look at the observations, and it doesn't bring you back to standard knowledge, then that's all right as well, because, again, it's the observations that are telling you. It's not your own sense of what things should be. Anyways, it's time to get the day started, and I will see you later. I'm going to try to vlog more throughout the day, but we'll see what ends up. But, we'll see what happens. Take it easy. Well, it is time for the next segment of the BTS vlogs. Yes, the BTS vlog. Single vlog. Singular. Anyways, you're watching the Life of a Nerd, Life of a Scientist. If you know the show Big Bang Theory, if you don't know the show, go take a look at for the TV show Big Bang Theory. And I'm the real life version of that. Minus the hot girl Penny. Just gotta add that disclaimer in there. It's about 10 to 5 in the morning. I started around 4 o'clock. I did everything I need to get done in terms of getting myself up. And now it's time to start the day. And so let me give you a time and date stamp. It is 0 hours and 47 minutes into the day of Tuesday, February 24th, I think it is, 2016. I'm still doing the one vlog a day, the one sort of talking to the camera a day. I still haven't gotten into the schedule yet. The schedule's starting to improve. I'm starting to knock off some of the projects. I will be getting to and finishing the work on the editing bay today. That means that the videos will start going up today as well. So that's a positive. What I'm deciding to do is sort of reveal some of the work I'm doing on the different projects I'm working on and the channels they're on. They're going to be on. I have a channel called INN. It's an internet news network. It looks like a news channel, but it's not actually a news channel. What it is I decided, as I was taking a look at the news and seeing, what's what, I realized that what I was doing is this matches up with observational psychology. You can use the news, the journalism, as a form of observational psychology. And this comes in not from the perspective of necessarily of cybernetics. Well, it is a psychology is a part of cybernetics. It is also part of physics as well, because quantum physics gives you the edge of regular physics, goes into anti-logical physics, and this is physics beyond our typical understanding. Physics beyond our typical logic, and there is these types of objects that we see but we don't fully understand. This would be black holes, this would be a variety of different other objects in space. And this is sort of what really brought a lot of quantum mechanics really into the forefront, is that the average person started seeing this. We started with the Hubble Space Telescope, and the images becoming public. We began to sort of see, the public began to see that there is a lot more out there. And even the scientists themselves were kind of shocked and puzzled, because what the Hubble showed us in terms of the imagery was beyond what what was expected. So that sort of gave the impetus to say, okay, there's more out there, but how much more is there out there? And so far, there is no edge to this. We haven't really found an edge, and no one really has a concrete answer. Everyone's looking around. There's a lot of different avenues to look in. And so my understanding of it is, because we'll go from quantum mechanics into superstring theory, and then further on out beyond that, because even superstrings doesn't necessarily cover everything, because superstrings itself is broken off into a variety of different flavors or subtypes of superstring theory. So they're not one superstring theory, but a variety of adjustments, if you will, or different views along the superstring theory that incorporate some of the ideas of superstring, but also incorporate others. And this includes M theory, or the manifold universe, where you have multiple parallel universes. And as soon as you start talking about parallel universes, because you have a God that because you have a God in history, if you do your research and you do a good enough research, you'll find that God actually, in many cases, there is a way to describe God in ancient theologies. There is a way of describing God in the same manner that you have quantum mechanics. So this gives you a quantum God. This now puts God back into the equation, because with quantum mechanics, because now you have an anti-logical universe. And with the Heisenberg uncertainty principle, you can't say for certain that there isn't a God. Now the equation of God comes back into view again, into your focus. And so what you want to do is you want to find a God that sort of parallels what you see in quantum mechanics. And there is a God that does that. There is a description of God, and that's, theology is the description of God, or the study of that particular thing, that God, or whatever description you find. So Theology is the overall subject of the study of God. So even polytheism or atheism is a study of God by definition, so they're all covered under theologies. But you can also describe it in many great cases as a metaphysics, if you will. So given the understanding that you have the M theory of superstring that says you have multiple parallel universes, which allows for a spiritual universe, do you now have enough to say, okay, let's put metaphysics out front, we'll have superstring M-full theories here, and you'll have quantum mechanics here. And what this quantum mechanics becomes, because you still have classical mechanics over here, which is deterministic, you can classify quantum mechanics as the dotted line on a boundary edge of a box. So the box, in determinate physics, which basically ended in 1950, deterministic physics ended there with the explosion of the atomic bomb. That kind of confirmed a lot of Einstein's theories about the nature of matter and brought into the scientific lab, really brought in the concept of the quantum universe as a probabilistic universe and no longer deterministic. In other words, there weren't really set laws, that the laws could be bent and changed depending on the quantum environment that you're in. So this was the whole thing, because under deterministic physics, that's your solid line. That's the determinant physics says everything is determined, everything has the law, and you have a solid line there, because they believed that was the end of the universe, and this is where you have statements coming out, now that we know everything, there is no more God, type of thing. You know, the God is dead type of comment that, oh yeah, science tells us everything. Well, no, science doesn't tell us everything, because that's only a deterministic point of view. Get to 1950, you have now the quantum view, and the quantum view doesn't give you a solid line, doesn't give you a defined edge of science. It gives you a probabilistic edge, that's a dotted line. And so you can go from quantum physics on out to the edge of physics, and the edge of physics is even further unknown. So instead of having a dotted line, maybe with superstring theory, you can add a dotted line or a thinly dashed line for M theory, and even further thinly shaded area for metaphysics. But now you can sort of start connecting these things. And news comes back into the physics view again, when you consider that psychology, the study of the soul, well, that's actually what psychology means. Psychology, by definition, is study of the soul, because psyche, the psych part, is psyche in Greek, which means the soul, and logia means the study of. So psychologia, or psychology, is the study of the soul. So you're back into metaphysics again, but now we actually have a quantum track that we can follow. And because the quantum track is always observational, observation leads theory, you now have to develop a observational psychology. And this is actually what you can do with the news. The news becomes observational psychology. So you can start testing out some of these ideas and looking for things as you're watching the news, or trying to sort of figure what's going on, how people are behaving in these particular environments. So there is an expansion to understand there, and you can bring news into observational psychology, which is now part of metaphysics, or we call it quantum psychology. So we're trying to see how these different physics sort of interact with each other. Do we have a comparable, is it something that we can compare? So do we not? You know, but a lot of the stuff is, it has to be done within your notes. You take your notes off your observation, and it is a lengthy process. It's not something that's short or easy. So that's what's on schedule today. That's what I've been doing. You know, 6 hours almost every day, 6-7 hours, going through different videos, looking for different behavior patterns and behavioral modifications, and sort of all the sort of the behavioral science type of thing. Is sort of looking for the spiritual aspect of the thing. And it's not as esoteric as you may think it is. It's not, you know, lighting candles and so on and so forth. This is actually really a physics. This is an observation. And you're looking for very specific mechanisms and mechanics that repeat itself in a sort of pattern behavior. And or sort of pattern mechanism. So, because the behavior...
Welcome to the library, and I am a librarian.
I am the professor. And professor of what? Professor of physics.
Oh, say, can you see by the dawn's early light?
Free speech rules here at Democratic Earth.